So I think it's about time to get started. Thank you very much for coming here, everyone. So for you who don't know it, I'm Erik Enroth, Professor Erik Enroth, chairman of this session. And I will just start by giving a short presentation of what we'll do here today. So this is the public defense for a degree of Doctor of Philosophy in Computing Science. And this is with the respondent, Ole Moiva Ibn Moyer, master's thesis, with a master's degree since before. Another of the main persons involved in this procedure is, of course, the faculty of Holland, Professor Roald Stadler from the Royal Institute of Technology at KTH, Stockholm. And then we have also invented the grading committee, equally important. So here we have three people. It's Docent Johanna Björklund from our own department here at the university. It's Dr. Giordano Casale from the Department of Computing Science, Department of Computing at Imperial College, London. And finally, Professor Simin Najim Terani from Linköping University in Sweden. And as I said, I'm Erik Enroth. And I will just quickly go through the procedure that we will follow today. So we start with the presentation of people involved, and that's already done. Then after that, the respondent will have a chance to give any further comments or addendum or any errata if there is anything to announce of that kind. After that, he will give a presentation, followed by a short presentation also by the opponent to put things in context. And after that, the respondent have another chance to give any comments and maybe corrections to what the opponent has presented or something like that, if that would be needed. And after that, we get into the interesting part with the opponent and respondent disputes. And then Professor Roald Stadler had the chance to ask questions and discuss with Ibn Moyer as long as he would need to be comfortable. After that, the examination board continues and asks questions and discusses in the same way. And after that, the floor is open to anyone here in the room to ask questions. In some countries, only people with PhDs are allowed to ask questions at this point, but that is not the same in Sweden, so everyone is free to ask questions. After that, the defense is closed here, and the examination board will convene and agree on a decision for this degree, while everyone else is invited to the coffee room at the Computing Science Department for coffee and tea and stuff. So, with that, I would like to leave over to the respondent to ask if you have any comments or any addendum or any errata or anything to present?
Not really. I have a few typos I found out after printing, but they're not enough to cause a misunderstanding of the concept in the thesis.
Hmm? So the thesis will be defended as it is?
Yes.
So then we'll leave over to you to start with the presentation.
I will be giving a talk on the work I've done during my PhD studies, which is titled Performance Anomaly Detection and Resolution for Autonomous Clouds. This work is motivated by the frequency at which performance incidents happen on the internet. We are talking about incidents like performance disruptions, degradation of services, and these incidents occur both in medium-scale services like Swedish Skate Brackets website, and also it happens in some of our most cherished services today. The impact of performance incidents in the internet can be very varied depending on the size of the online services in question. We have this financial side of the impact, and then we also have the operational side. On the financial impact, a report by Abilene Group states that an additional 1 second delay in page response time could lead to a reduction in traffic to the website by 11%, and which in turn leads to a reduction in revenue by 7%. On the operational side, when disruptions happens in services, users give a very bad rating for the application or the system. And then this in turn leads to lower reliability of the system. And eventually it takes a lot of effort for the service operators and the staff to investigate the cause of the problem and find out where exactly the problem stems from and what can be done to restore services. Interestingly, when before or during an incident, there are some measurable observations that can be made within the system and the applications that are running them. Usually, users would report cases of intermittent delays. For example, it takes longer time for you to be able to download the files on Dropbox, or sometimes you're not able to access your desired service as you would like to. On the side of the engineers that are in charge of these operations, they also can measure things like abnormal use of resources in the virtual machines that are running on the cloud, or the applications, or in the services themselves. So, after this background, we want the next concern is to figure out how do enterprise manage performance incidents. This is my own interpretation of the current state of the art or state of practice in organizations. This is inspired from a new article that was released by the Software Analytics Group in Microsoft. Basically, enterprise will deploy integrated monitoring systems that will collect a lot of a number of KPIs. The KPIs in this case, key performance indicators, from different services and servers, and then they deploy some techniques that would track these metrics over time and be able to figure out when there is a problem. If they are able to figure out symptoms like delays or failure, then they send, these techniques would automatically send an alert to a human object, or to a human engineer in this case. And the job of the engineer is basically to attend to this alert, investigate what the problem is, and then figure out what actions can be done to restore service. One problem with this approach is that we can see that the human takes an important but intrusive role in the process. And this could lead to a bottleneck if you have a large-scale system. So, in the real sense, when we consider the scale of the cloud today, it is undesirable to have this role occupied by a human. This is for two major factors. The first one is the scale of the cloud itself. A single enterprise can own over 1,000 virtual machines running different applications across different clouds. And then if you look at the size of a single data center, for example, Google, on average, per data center has 75,000 servers. It is non-trivial to imagine how this, it is trivial to imagine how difficult this would be for a human to handle, considering that each of these servers, in combination with the services, can generate millions of metrics and data points per second. And then if you also consider that, given the size and the interdependencies between components in a typical data center, it is quite easy to see how varied the source of problems could be. Secondly, we have the issue of dynamism. Really, when you look at the applications in running on the internet, there is a variability in the amount of traffic that goes in and out of these applications. And just as the workload traffic is dynamic, you can expect the composition of these applications and the topology of the data center to change over time because of the elastic and on-demand nature of the way applications are provisioned in the cloud. And also, this means that eventually, what used to be normal in the past may cease to be normal right now, and in the future, it could become abnormal. So it is hard to imagine how a human would be able to manipulate, investigate problems and fix issues having to deal with this kind of complexity. Hence, we looked at a situation where we would have the human take, not that we would completely eliminate the human, but it would take more or less a guidance position. But the first thing is that we have to take out the human in this loop, so we basically eliminate the bottleneck, and then we have a tighter, more integrated architecture. So in this architecture, we're going to have a more nearly closed loop setup, where we have two main modules that would support the entire problem management procedure. So basically, we would use the monitoring to collect data, and then we'll have analytics that crunches the data and then summarizes results or generates models or insights that can be used for detection of problems, investigating the source of the problem, and also finding, making recommendations. Here, the human can then be in position of helping to guide the system in a way that balances confusion, for example, when there is low confidence for some actions or for some resource, then the human can come in to use high-level knowledge of the domain to fix the problem. Before we can achieve this aim, before we can achieve the cycle I showed you earlier, then we envision that we would need three main properties to be able to do this. The first is that we want the system to be sort of self-adaptive, to be able to adapt to the changing landscape and workload of the application. We also want the system to be able to take advantage of the long rate dependencies in different parts of the network. And then eventually, considering that many cloud applications and systems have a commonality in terms of their topology and composition and design, and then we would want to be able to transfer the same type of the same system to be used for different use cases without having to modify the core of the techniques. This led us to come up with three main research objectives. So the first one is that given the large number of articles or research articles in this area, we want to assess what has been done, majorly the research contributions, trends and open challenges, with a focus on what techniques have been used to detect symptoms, which we call anomalies. Secondly, we want to also, based on the inspiration from the assessment, we want to develop anomaly detection techniques that bear the characteristics that we mentioned earlier. And lastly, we want to be able to develop techniques that bear resemblance to the closed loop system that we showed earlier, where we have limited human intervention. So in the next few slides, I'm going to be introducing our main research contributions. I will introduce a few, some of the papers and how we have some of the papers and how they relate to the research objective. And then I will pick some that will show some results. For the assessment, that is the first research objective, we performed a comprehensive research survey covering over 40 research articles spanning a decade. The papers that we looked at covered different system domains like grid or distributed systems and cloud systems. The focus of 53% of the papers was on detecting anomalies, for example, increase in response time, changes in the level of the CPU utilization. And the 29% of these papers also focus on finding root causes of these symptoms. And 18% papers combine the two. Because the focus has been on detection, we try to classify these papers using the strategies, that is the philosophy behind the detection, using summary information about the metrics, for example, signature, or using domain knowledge about the network or the system that we're considering. And then we'll also look at the methods that were actually performed, that were used. Prominently, on one hand, we have statistical techniques, and then we have machine learning techniques that are a bit more data-driven. We also propose a cause-effect taxonomy that shows how root causes from different parts of the IT stack can lead to bottlenecks and eventually manifest to users as, say, performance degradation. The results of this survey have been presented in a peer-reviewed article in a journal. The second research objective is like the bulk of our contribution. We studied three main problems under this area. So I will start with the first problem. The first problem was came about as a result of a joint collaboration between our group and our industrial partners at Intel Island. The problem was that given the landscape or the topology graph of a cloud network, we want to be able to figure out which node at any point in time is experiencing manifestation of bottlenecks. For example, saturation of resources or overutilization of resources. Due to the scale of the system and the scale of the topology and the fact that we want is the thing that is able to do this online and fast enough, we propose a technique that reasons about what is the state of each node using fuzzy rules. And then we do this reasoning over domain knowledge in that we got from expert. Because we could have, at any point in time, multiple alarms, we then try to sort of use the interdependencies between different nodes to rank them. The algorithm that we proposed was inspired by the PageRank algorithm developed by Google. The results from this work resulted in two peer-reviewed conference papers. So in the second problem, we look at a different type of anomaly detection. In this case, we have a time series of different performance metrics that we collected in real time. And the goal is to be able to figure out at which time point we have what we call contextual anomalies. I will go a little bit into detail on this problem in a few slides. We developed an unsupervised and adaptive, or two unsupervised and adaptive techniques. We investigated the differences between the two, and then we evaluated these techniques using computing systems data from Yahoo. We have also published this in a journal article. And lastly, we extended the previous problem to the multivariate case. So the point here is that we studied this problem within the context of a cluster, of a cloud cluster. We have multiple different nodes running at the same time. And for each node, we track over time the main system resource utilization. So we have a multi-dimensional time series problem. Then the point is, at each time point, how do we figure out if the current measurement is anomalous given the previous observation? So in this case, we propose a forecasting-based technique that is able to use previous measurement to predict what will be the expected measurement, and then use that as a basis for anomaly detection. We evaluated the detection on real testbed in our laboratory, and then we estimated how accurate the forecasting is with data from a European private cloud. We have also published this in a peer-reviewed conference. So I will go back to the second problem under detection, which is detecting contextual anomalies in KPI time series. So the problem here is that we want to be able to figure out which points at any point in time, which measurement at any point in time is anomalous given only the past. So we don't have complete knowledge of the entire stream, and also we can see here that the streams can be diverse depending on the type of metric we're looking at. So we want a technique that is a bit generic and agnostic to the shape of the time series and also the different characteristics of the time series. So the contextual nature of the anomalies here is the fact that at one point, for example here, this measurement is abnormal because we circled it. And another point, for example, the adjacent measurement is not anomalous, it's normal. So this makes it very difficult to detect in real time. So how do we do this? We hypothesize that instead of looking at the values of the metrics themselves, because it's kind of complicated to do that, if you look at the magnitude of each time series is different, this is ranging between 0 and 1.0, and this is ranging between 1,500 and minus 1,500 to 1,500. So it's hard to come up with a single technique that makes use of the raw data as it comes. But then we hypothesized that we could instead track some sort of underlying behavior of the data. And then if we do this, over time we can detect changes in this underlying behavior, and that could be used as a basis for anomaly detection. We propose two online techniques, and they are also supervised for this purpose. The first technique is called the behavior-based anomaly detection. Here is a pure machine learning technique, and we do not take advantage of the temporal nature of time series. Basically, we have a density estimator that estimates what we call the underlying behavior of the recent window of pure data. So here is the pure data that goes into the density estimator, and with the density estimator will use the adaptive kernel density estimation technique to figure out when you have new observation, you want to basically ask a question, what is the likelihood of the normal data to have, the normal distribution to have generated this new data point. So if we have that, which we call the conditional density, then we can use some sort of control chart to figure out when this, so the conditional density in this case is the statistical property that I mentioned earlier. So then if we do this, we want to figure out if the observation YT is normal or abnormal. The theory behind that is that for density-based techniques, the assumption is that normal data usually occur in very dense regions. So they have high density values. But anomalies will have, they occur in sparse regions. Then they will have very small density values. So we can use some reasonable threshold, we can figure out which one is abnormal. So the learning process, the incremental learning process, uses what we call tumbling window or jumping window, where we use one window to test the next window. The second technique is based on predicting the time series itself. So here we want to take advantage of the temporality. What I mean temporality is that there is a dependence between adjacent measurements. So we have a predictor that approximates the recent past, it approximates a model, and the model can be used to do some sort of predict the expected behavior of the process generating the time series. And then eventually when we have the observation, we can then compare, find the distance between the observed value and the expected value. The distribution of this distance can be used as a basis for anomaly detection as well. We evaluated these techniques on the Yahoo data, as I said earlier, and then we also do some cross-testing with different time series from different data sets. Here, I will show some important results. Here we have aggregated results. This is the median value when we aggregate the results from across over 40 time series from the test data. The first point to note is that we observe that exploiting temporality is very important as it improves the performance of the prediction-based techniques that explicitly does this compared to the bad technique, which doesn't, especially if you consider the first alarm rate. The recall here is the percentage of anomalies present in the data. the ratio between the number of anomalies detected and the number of anomalies present in the data. Secondly, we observe that algorithms, online algorithms like the one we propose, offer competitive performance compared to techniques that make use of the complete information about the time series. So they have the complete view, they have the entire time series before fitting them to do detection. In our case, we have only used a recent window to do the detection. So to do this, we tested our technique with Twitter's algorithm, which is the latest anomaly detection package around. And then we observed that though the technique is able to generate very low false positive, it misses quite a lot of anomalies, 25%. That's quite a lot if you look at the impact that could have on end user performance. And finally, we discovered that retrofitting offline techniques may not always work. So just to be fair, that we are using the same methodology, learning methodology between the Twitter algorithm and our techniques, we implemented the Twitter algorithm to support what we call incremental learning. And then we pass it over the same set of data. And we figure out that the technique performed way worse than we would expect. And that's the end of the objective two. So objective three, which is with this with the resolution. We propose a technique that addresses the problem of how should we detect or mitigate performance degradation, often caused by capacity shortages in the cloud. We basically look at a situation where we consider that the goal the management goal is to keep quality of service in a state where the performance is high and the efficiency is high. However, because of the variability in workload demands, we often observe situations where the quality of service jumps between good states and bad states. Then, if we look at the workload variability and the nature of the quality of service states, it's hard to come up with models that can relate workload and quality of service. We also know that this could also be difficult to do for different applications and different metrics. So we looked at what could we do. But then we found out that the model-free and interactive decision-making process offered by reinforcement learning seemed to be a good fit to address this problem. So in that, we proceeded to apply this. But before, I would like to give you a brief of the process of the procedure with reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning is basically an interactive interaction between an agent and a control system. An agent, in our case, is a resource allocator, or a scheduler, if you will, and the control system is the an application or a system in under study. The agent will continually monitor the state of the application via some KPIs, and then it will continually take actions to drive the state of the environment to a desired state. And over time, it will also try to either incentivize its actions or penalize its actions. It will continue to do this in order to maximize long-term reward. And how does it do this? To try to figure out a policy that maps the right action to the right state over time. This inspired us to extend this procedure to contain what we call, instead of deterministic states, then we can have stochastic states. So we have the system to be in multiple states. The reason for this is because we have multiple metrics for the state description. And then it could, if you go with the single state, it could take a long time to explore. So what we did was to come up with an architecture that looks like this. I have three components. The first component is the state detector. It observes the quality of service metrics over time, and then it will formulate it as a fuzzy state problem, and then it will, at every time, it will recognize the system to be in a number of fuzzy states. To quicken the exploration of the state action mappings, the capacity controller will deploy a set of goal-seeking reinforcement learning agents that will collaborate together to figure out what is the best action to drive the quality of service to a desired state. And then the aggregated action will be applied on the system understudy, and then it would allow the system to go to rest, and then we'll continue the learning until the end of the learning episode. We evaluated this technique on a real test bed containing an application benchmark, which really worked close. But here I will try to show only some results. So here we run the application in a visualized environment with an extreme workload that looks like a step function. This type of workload is good to study systems like this because they are able to allow us to understand or investigate the behavior of the technique in the extreme case. One thing that is clear here is that, okay, before that, the first plot on the plot on the left, the first one on top represents the performance, the response time, and the one below represents the resource allocation and resource utilization. So the first thing that is clear is that the graph for the resource allocation and utilization maps seem to be close to the shape of the workload. This means that we are able to control the resource utilization, which is one of the quality of service requirements. We're able to control it, which we expect, or let me say, adapt it to the workload as they come, instead of over-provisioning the resources. And if we look at on the side of performance, we observe that the performance measurement is mostly around the target. In this case, we're trying to control the mean time response time to 0.5 seconds. This seemed to be the case here, except at points where we experience this sharp increase in and it takes a bit of time for the agents to learn that, okay, there is a new change in the level of the workload and allocate resources appropriately. Basically correct this spike. So for example here, this is an example of anomalies. I have summarized this graph into a summary table. So we take average over the experiment time. We observe that the average response time is truly 0.5 seconds. And then that the efficiency is 96%. That is quite high, given that in the setup of the algorithm, we could prioritize performance over capacity allocation or utilization, and we did just that. So we give performance high priority. And then here is the adaptation. So this is the rate at which it takes our techniques to make performance to converge to around the target, especially after an increase or a decrease in workload. And then we take an average of that, and this is what we have. In our experiment, we have the control interval is about 10 seconds. So this 7.9 means that we're able to control, we're able to convert, the system is able to adapt the performance around 1 minute to, around 1 minute or 1.9. So this shows that our technique is able to meet quality of service requirement, balancing the trade-off between performance and efficiency while keeping the users happy, because then we have fewer anomalies. And in conclusion, we have presented, I have presented my thesis that is in the context of performance management and troubleshooting. I have presented the result or an overview of a comprehensive literature survey, and I've also introduced you to some online techniques that we have used to detect anomalies in KPIs of systems time series. And for the resolution objective, we have also presented a model-free adaptive techniques to mitigate performance degradation via capacity adjustment. The results of the research activities have been spread over 2 peer-reviewed journals, 4 peer-reviewed conference articles, 1 conference poster, and 1 technical report. In general, the outcomes of our research can be used in two ways. The first is that the comprehensive literature survey, while it organizes the body of knowledge in a systematic manner, can be not just as a basis for further research, but also as a basis for education and development in the industry. We also believe that our techniques could inspire developers and researchers on how to apply incremental techniques and model-free learning for online incident management. And we believe that our techniques are also applicable, as they are, in allied fields such as IoT sensors and others. So I want to use this opportunity to thank my supervisor, my assistant supervisor, and I would like to mention that Francisco is not here. He started with being my assistant supervisor in the beginning of my studies before me took over because he left the university. So I would like to thank everyone. I'd like to thank the members of the Distributed Systems Group, everyone in the audience, and the committee, and the opponents. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So then we move over to the presentation by the opponent. Then,
maybe it's just easy.
Yeah, this one.
I take it from here. Just for the question and answer period, you might.
Okay.
So you see, then, if you could see me the cable. Yeah. All right. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Robert Strada, and I'm opponent in the thesis. I'd like to thank Mui for the interesting presentation, and of course for the thesis. And so, what I want to do, I have only three slides, so I want to make it quick, and I want to give you my general impression about the thesis, the high level impression, and then during the question answer period, we can go into a little more. So, I thought myself first, you know, what I really like about the thesis, having read the document. And so I would point this out in terms of where I think the thesis for me stands out. So the first thing is this is really a very well written piece of work. So I have read quite a few theses, PhD thesis in my career, and this is one of the, I would say, the best written. So I would like to congratulate you. Either you are natural talent in writing or you work very hard. It probably was a combination of both. So if you have PhD students here who want to know how to write a thesis well, read a couple of pages in this. It's very well written. The language is clear and concise. When you make figures, the figures make sense. You have few figures, but they're important. Right. So for me, it was the thesis is not always easy to understand the concept. But this is not about the language. So when I read the thesis, I never had the idea I have to figure out what he meant here. You know, it was always clear. The thing was that you wanted to get a grasp of the concept. Okay. So I think that is very well done. The second thing which is important here is the methodology, basically. What did you employ? How do you go about getting results? Huh? And basically, for me, the subject of the thesis is the subject of engineering of network systems. So this is where you're coming from. You use the craft basically in the engineering techniques in this field to do that. But you combine this with method knowledge. This is which is normally not in depth available in our field. This thesis has a lot of statistical knowledge in it, and you apply it, and in more depth than usual. And so I thought you have either worked together with somebody who is a statistician, or you really worked hard basically to get additional knowledge. And the thing is what you're trying to do here basically you're bringing two domains together, namely this engineering ecosystem and the for me the statistical learning domain, right? And to get results of depth you have to understand both. And for me this is an example of successfully doing this. So then, specifically, if you try to employ method for machine learning, it's important that you show that this method actually generalizes. You validate this on not just on one data set, but you try to validate it on several data sets, right? Which come from different environments. And this tells you something about the quality of the method, not just a single data set. And you do that in most of the time in your thesis. There are things where you don't do it, and I'm going to point those out with pleasure later. But with important results, you do that. You normally have a laboratory set up where you do your own experiments, create your own data, but you also take traces from somewhere else. And then basically you see how your method basically, your proposed method performs in those. Your work is quite informed about industry practice. I understand for the first two papers I have been working with people from Intel, but also in other works you describe what people are doing in the industry. And that is very important because it gives the work relevance. It's not just a theoretical study and people in industry say, yeah, but this is a completely different way. And so many of the concepts you said can be applied basically. So I like that. And then the last point you mentioned is you have 6 publications in direct connection basically with the thesis. You publish them at good venues, 2 journal publications, 1 transaction journal paper. And so this is I mean these days, unfortunately. These days, people do not read a lot of PhD theses anymore, but they read publications. This is the way, basically, to disseminate most of the knowledge which you, and I think it's very well done. Last night I was looking at the citation. So you published basically over the last 3 years, no? 2015, 16, 17, and the survey paper has, I think, 40 references in Google Scholar. That's a good start, so I accumulate more. But it shows me that your work is actually people looking at your work. All right, so this is channel comments. Now, why is this work significant? And I think for two reasons. The first reason is important, the other thing is actually hard to do, it's a hard problem. So it's important because basically, it enables clouds that support critical services, time critical services, performance critical services, and this can be business critical application. This can be application for society, which are critical that they function, and so on. And these are the clouds which we're designing right now. These are the future telecom infrastructures, the future telecom services. So. If you believe this is important, this work is important. And I think everybody here believes that the future telecom infrastructure can be a cloud infrastructure. So you have to understand this. So this is the first thing. Now, the question is why do we love clouds? Yeah, we love clouds because Cloud technologies have been very, very successful the last years. We all know you can easily configure new services. You can scale. You can scale resources up. You can use statistical multiplexing among applications, among different tenants. So cloud technology have a lot of advantages. But also there are things which are very hard to do, right? And basically two things that in cloud environment that belong together here. So the first thing is it's very hard to say something about the end-to-end performance of a cloud service. Very hard, very hard. And the reason is because cloud systems are very complex systems. So you have hardware, you have several layers of software, and so the system complexity argument comes in here. What you do traditionally, I think you have described this in the thesis, if you want to say something about the performance aspect of a cloud, in principle, if you would like to do that, then you would have to come up with a stochastic model, no, of this thing. You have to apply queuing theory. And for that, you need to know the architecture of the thing and how the components talk to each other and the algorithms, and that ends up to be a very, very complex system. Very, very complex system, and in practice, you cannot do that. So the traditional way of system modeling fails here. So you have to look for something else, like statistical learning methods, which you use. So you observe the system, and based on that, you build a model, and then you work with that. Right? So, there's more. Sometimes you cannot, if you look at a modern cloud system, you know, some of the components maybe you might have insight in, you have written yourself, or you take open source, but some of the component may be close to you. They're proprietary. So traditional method, so you have to apply a gray box model or a black box model. So again, this isn't very difficult to do, and you have to come up with new methods. For example, statistical learning. And this is what we do. And the same thing is for resource and performance of a ready problem, exactly the same thing. All right, so in principle, it's an important problem domain, and it's very hard to do something about it. But we have. If you want to have 5G system, that 5G system in the future that support the type of application we want, we have to solve these problems. All right. Last slide here, where I see the major contributions. So if you talk about fault management or anomalies, then basically you have three tasks to do. Number one, you have to detect that there's something wrong. You have to detect an anomaly. This is the first thing. The second thing is you may want to identify the root cause. Why is it happening? You don't understand that. And then the third thing is you want to mitigate it. And basically, you in all these three areas, when it comes to performance analysis, this work made contributions. Right. So detection, you have this paper 4, anomaly detection in streams, which you extend then basically to multivariate streams. You have a concept about the automatic landscape coloring and ranking of the nodes there. So you can basically start addressing anomalies with the node you feel is most anomalous. And then the last paper basically where you look at the very specific problem of SLA violation, what you can do about that with using vertical scaling as an example. All right. So from this point of view, you have not solved the problem, all the problems in the field, but basically in all these areas you have made contributions. I would say here and here you gave a complete solutions. Here I think you outlined possible solutions. But still, I would think it's a contribution to the field. Right. And with that, I would like to move over to the questioning, if that's okay.
Yeah, thank you very much. First, Muriel, yes. If you have any further comments to this, or you want to correct your opponent, or anything like that?
No comment.
Yep. Otherwise, please enter the stage and we move over to the question discussion. I'm not sure, maybe just keep the laptop over here.
Right, but so the way I suggest it, I have a couple of questions I want to ask. Oh, we should switch the screen here. The way and then maybe I ask you to bring up a page, a specific page or figure from your thesis, and then we're gonna discuss that particular. I would like to basically focus on the last four papers, which are in your thesis, and would like to start with paper 3. So if you could go to page 140, figure 1. It shows a so-called landscape graph, which a concept which I think is not yours, it's an Intel concept, no?
Is it?
So page 140, page 140, figure 1.
So far it's just the landscape, not the landscape graph.
Right.
Okay. That's not good enough for me, that's good.
All right. All right, very good. So this is an example. So, right, so this is an Intel concept. And so you have here basically three layers of entities. First of all, here is the physical entity, like the physical machine. Then you have virtual entity, like the virtual machine. You have application on top. And now what you're doing is you are assigning states, the two-dimensional states, to all these nodes, and then you're using these states basically to identify anomalous states or not, whether a particular state is anomalous. And then if a state is anomalous, the node becomes anomalous. So in the end, you have a couple of column nodes here, right? And you're going to rank them. In this case, using PageRank 3 plus some other thing, and which allows them to address in sequence, you know. So that's the idea behind this. All right. Now let's go to this state space here, right? And that page 142. Right here. So each of these nodes have now such a state space attached. This state space says something like a particular resource. No, that is that. So here, let's say I have a physical thing. So this is maybe CPU utilization and CPU saturation. So how many requests are waiting? And at any point in time, this particular node has a space, like a vector here, so I can be here, I can be here, I can be here, I can be here. Right. Now, what you're doing is you're partitioning this state space in this case, six states. So the system is either here, or here, or here. My question is, how did you come up with 6? Why not 4? Why not 9? Why not 733? Is this intuition, or did you experiment with this? How did you come up with this?
Okay. The first reason for this 6 states is due to the human interpretation of what the different levels that the saturation metric can be, and the different level that utilization metric can be. For example, it's when we were working on this problem, to get the boundaries for each of these levels, before I discretized like this, what I did was to ask the collaborators that, do they think it makes sense to reason about utilization at the medium level? If they think it makes sense to say that saturation is either low or high. It is hard to come up with medium saturation.
Okay, so it has nothing to do with computation complexity or so.
Not at all.
Okay. Okay. Then what you're doing basically, you're saying actually, you know, the system, if the system is here, maybe it's in two different states or so, then so you use fuzzy
yes.
Concept basically to say system can be in several states. And now from a theoretical point of view, this is very satisfying because you can say this is the way I capture uncertainty, you know. But you could also argue if you use these fuzzy states, you're introducing complexity to the model. No? So did you try with and without fuzzy states, and did you get any difference in terms of you know, finding faults? Or my intuition would tell me, I'm a guy who always likes to do things as simple as possible. I would say forget about fuzzy state at the beginning, and let's see whether we can find faults that way. Did you do that, or did you? Why these fuzzy states? Why are they?
Okay. The reason for the fuzzy state was that when to get the boundaries, as I said earlier, I did some sort of I sent around a survey for engineers and researchers, and then I asked them to tell me what they think would be a high CPU utilization or low CPU saturation. And then I figured that the range given by these experts sort of overlapped. Then it became difficult to figure out what exactly is high. Or where does high stop being high and becomes medium? And because of that, I reasoned that it seems like the boundary is going to be fuzzy.
Right.
It's going to be soft.
Right.
Because for different applications, it could be different
right.
Highness or
right. Right.
So that's the reason why we use the fuzzy.
Yeah, but not only would that mean, but that just make, you know, more, I quantify more. This is low, this is semi-low, this is medium, and something like this. Was it possible?
Yeah, the point here is that though I didn't present the results of the question that you asked, if we did try the static thresholds or deterministic states, but what I observed was that without the fuzzy states, it was the result was a bit deterministic, number one. Number two,
there's no problem with it.
It was, yes. Number two, because of the hard threshold for the boundaries, then it became hard to distinguish when there is actually, we are in the bad states. Because sometimes we're just on the boundary. But with the fuzzy state, you can get some sort of confidence that tells us that, okay, we're in a bad state 70% of the time.
Right.
Or 20% of the time, and that can be used by the fuzzy reasoning to actually figure out what exactly the final state would be. That's the reason why we use it.
All right, okay, cool. Now comes the thing which I think, when I looked at this, I was not so sure what you wrote in it. Because basically now you can come and say, now I have to bring in an expert who knows the application, who knows about the SLA, you know,
yes.
and who knows about the infrastructure. And that expert tells me now which of these six states are known and which not. No?
That is not what we did.
Okay. Good idea. For me, your thesis, my impression is the following, that you now say, this state is anomalous, this state is anomalous, and if the vector is somewhere here, then you label the node as a node.
Yes, yes, that's what we did, actually, it's true.
Okay.
But the reason for that was that the designation of states, I explained in the thesis, that it depends on the requirements.
Yeah, right.
So it depends on the goal.
And now this is exactly the point. And this is exactly the point. So you have to bring somebody in who knows about the goal of the system. We want to save energy.
Yes.
We want to make the customer happy. We want to have a very, we want to have a very high capacity, service capacity. And the thing is now, if I think about, I have a very large infrastructure. You said that Google has 5,000. I mean, they're even larger. And I have a lot of applications on this thing. And now I have to fill up this map. And so if I know application A very well and what the SLA is, and so I can say, aha, probably this might be an anomalous or this might be an anomalous, but it's not. But for another application, let's say I have a best effort application, this actually might be very good if I drive it here, right? So I doubt a little bit that in a large heterogeneous environment is actually feasible, you know, to label this state correctly. What would you say?
Okay, but yeah, for the use case that we studied, this was good enough.
For the use case,
but then,
yes.
If we're going to be able to generalize this to,
exactly,
to different applications, I agree that we would have to find a way to, we can't, it is intractable to expect that we'll get users who understand all the applications.
Right.
But the right thing would be that if I would work on this again,
mm-hmm.
so that I would find a way to be able to learn what, how to discretize the metrics, because then we may have more than two metrics, because then we will not be able to represent the states in two dimensions, and it will be hard for us to visualize it, let alone quantifying it. So if I would do this again, I would probably find a technique that would automatically learn how to discretize, probably getting feedback from a human expert.
Right. So I think I tend to agree with you. So to bring a human expert in on this level in a large system is probably hopeless. You have to bring the person in on a higher level,
yes.
and then translate that. Maybe using machine learning.
Yes.
Okay. I think that's fine. Right. Very good. So then let's move to the next paper. And we go to page 200. No, let me see here. We go to page. We go to page 165, figure 1. So here you develop two schemes for univariate for anomaly detection in univariate matrices. So here is a matrix frame, let's say CPU utilization. And after every second you have a measurement come in, and then you put this into a buffer of size k, in the case 6 to 20 or something like this, and then you have two different ways of estimating, two different methods. I can use one or both, the other one or both. Huh? Right. Now, the first method, you use an estimation window. All of them are over a window, huh? and the first one you say you're using a tumbling window, basically here, and then after k time steps you see chumps. The second you use a sliding window, basically every time step is big. So in the first one, if you have a window of size k, every k seconds you make an assessment whether it's an anomaly or not. Every time step. Yes, of course.
So in the first case, we take the last k
mm-hmm.
Window with k observation.
Mm-hmm.
We will use that the model estimated from that mm-hmm. window to sort of classify the next k observation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what it's called with the tumbling.
Right.
And then when we classify that, we would only retain the normal data within that window.
Right.
So the from which we would estimate a new model, and then we'll do that. Right. So basically, so the classification is not every k.
Aha, uh-huh. The classification is
every
Every time step. Oh, okay. So that, because yes. that was
but then we changed the model learning.
Right.
Every K.
Okay. Now, oh, now I see. Okay. So then I didn't fully understand it because I thought here you can something every K time step, something every time step, and that my question would have been, you know, why can't we do this every time step? Of you,
just like it's really the same.
Yeah. Okay. So then that's fine. All right. Then we and then you find out for example you have problems if there is a time pattern in the transnerves, this is not so good, but this is better. But I think, so that's a difference basically.
Yes.
Now let's and then basically you apply this to very different streams, you know. One is Yahoo, but then you also were looking at networking data. And I think I want to look at some of this evaluation. So can you go page 183, table 6. Okay, yeah, load it a little bit up. So is this table 6?
Yes. This is
the actually there's some two things which are interesting here. So the first row shows your evaluation on physical mode. No?
That's another paper.
Okay, that's another paper. We just don't want to make things more complicated by mixing stuff up. But what I wanted to point out here is this thing: your method performs very well on certain data streams and very badly on other data streams. For instance, if on this Amazon performs very
well. Because all the three are actually our methods. So
fine. But my point is the following. What stands out here, this thing performs very poorly here, no?
Yes.
So on networking data. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to get a feeling from you, or a result from you, or a comment from you why that is.
Yes. The reason was that in some previous results in the same section,
right,
I've done some benchmarking to see which method the tumbling window technique, mm-hmm, based on behavior, or mm-hmm, the one that exploits temporality, which is the prediction method.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted to see which one is better on time series with cyclical behavior, seasonality,
nice,
and those ones. So here we wanted to see if the same behavior repeats. Right. And it was clear that we did. The quality of service, web service data here, they are non-seasonal. So that's why the first method performs relatively good. But here, they are not, they are seasonal.
Cycles in there.
Yes, and then the prediction techniques is consistent across.
That's clear. Okay, very good. So let's go to the next paper. Page 205, figure 4. This is where you have, you also analyze data streams, but now you have a multivariate, basically. There are data streams coming at you, not just from a single variable, but from several variables at the same time. And what did I say? Page 205, figure 4. 205. Yeah, this one. Okay, I have to say, basically, you use this as a motivation figure for your work. And I have to say, I see this. I kind of knew this before, but I see this for the first time, and this was an eye-opener for me. Because look at this thing. Basically, it says, so these are streams from same node. Huh?
Yes.
From single node. So this is you have CPU, you have memory. This is your utilization. CPU utilization, memory utilization, disk I/O, network access. And so the first thing you see that if you look each stream in by itself, you see there's autocorrelation.
Yes.
This is what we see. So if this autocorrelation is the higher, basically the closer you are.
Yes.
Huh? right? So this is the first thing you see. The other thing is you see this cross correlation. So high CPU normally also means high memory. Also normally means high. So this is actually quite interesting to see. It's intuitively clear, but this is this is how it's out. And obviously, the further you are away from the current time, the more this thing declines. Okay. So I think this is for me this was a very.
The motivation for this was that I needed to put this to show that in some previous articles in the area, sometimes researchers do not care about it, just forget about the fact that most machine learning techniques do not honor this type of correlation. Mm-hmm. And they just throw machine learning algorithms to time series data.
Mm-hmm.
And then that can result in different kind of results that is inconsistent.
Right.
So I wanted here to prove that the method that I'm going to use is well motivated and it's right. The right.
That's right. So I think this is well done. And then you came up with basically anomaly detection that takes this cross correlation into account.
Yes.
Locally for each node.
Yes.
And for each node now, a node in your landscape graph. So this can be a virtual machine or can be a physical machine. Yes. This, and then you rank them. And then. All right. So let's go to page 217, table 1. So what I see here, now this is what I mixed it up with the row before. What I see here, if you look at the row above, this tells you how good your forecasting method is. So R2, for example, means close to 1 means you're very, very good. Below, you're worse. What I see here is that you can, if you measure if you measure the physical machine, your prediction are better.
Yes.
Than if you measure on a virtual machine. Why is that?
I think.
Prediction.
I think the metrics at the physical layer are actually closer to the reality than the ones at the for example, really here, the results here shows that it's harder to predict this IO for the VMs, across the VMs here,
right,
than at the nodes.
So why is that?
For example, we run this experiment on the Zen testbed, and the IO request doesn't go directly from the application to the disk, it has to go through the hypervisor. And due to the bursting nature of IO network, it became harder to predict. Unlike if you're on the host, we can actually measure.
Right, but you also have, on the physical layer, you have metric, obviously, of the physical utilization, but in a virtual machine, you have metrics.
An abstraction of the
and you
devices.
See, right, but are you saying if you have a VM with 50% resource CPU utilization, this 50% is not as accurate as on the physical layer? Is this what you're saying?
Especially on the for the disk case.
Fine.
Even for the CPU, it can be if you measure the what is observed in the host for a VM. And what you observe inside the VM, there may be different.
Okay, so that is your explanation why we see this.
Yes.
Difference. All right. Okay. Then maybe let me look at another table, namely page 220, table 4. So basically, this is from prediction. On your test bed?
Actually, detection.
detection
on the test space, yes.
Right, right. So you run application, you throw this application, you have SLA, response time requirements, and you use a method here, huh? And then the question is, can you show any correlation between the anomaly detected from your method on the physical and logical node and response time violation from rules, no? This is what...
There's a plot somewhere down
here. Right. Let me see. I hope I got this right. Let me double check. I see here. I see paper, study table 4. here.
That's what we capture with the relevancy.
Okay.
So yes. How relevant are the alarms that we detect in the nodes? How do they relate with the service degradation?
Okay. So what I wrote down here in Matengi, your experiment shows that 22% of the SLA violations can be explained, but directly explained by alarms you find. This is what this thing says. One of them,
yes.
No? All right. And so now this needs some explaining. You know, I would like to help you understand that. So you have your test bed. You run your application. The load is such that it is stationary, basically. You should not see any violation. And now you introduce some contention, huh? Right? And therefore you have violation. And therefore what you have anomalies. Okay. And so for, I don't know how to 62 maps to the and so for 62% of the SLA violations, you find corresponding anomalies.
For 62%.
Here's the
62. Yeah. Right. 62% for 62% of alarms at the system level, we find the corresponding.
Okay. So that is the, but. So it's not for 62% of the SLA violations.
No.
Okay, but still you have some SLA violations where you do not find alarms, no?
What we see is that we have some alarms where we do not find SLA violation. And the reason for that is...
Actually quite a lot.
Yeah, and the reason for...
Why is that?
Okay, the reason for that is that at the system level, and this is why we compute some sort of lead time,
mm-hmm.
At the system level, before you... users get to experience a degradation.
Mm-hmm.
You usually have this onset time where you already have some deviation in system level metrics.
Mm-hmm.
And that deviation list comes off to the alarms that we get before it. The user gets to observe the latency reduction or increase.
Okay.
And that is what we use to compute towards the lead time.
Oh, so that was that, okay. You say there's a delay and you capture this lead time and then you make this out of a problem, you make an opportunity because you say I can actually in advance,
yes,
say that I'm going to see an SLA violation. All right. Question here: how often do you sample? When these metrics come in, is this every second, every 10 seconds, every?
I think for these experiments, it was like every 30 seconds.
Every 30 seconds.
Yes.
Every 30 seconds.
Yes.
All right. Now, so every 30 seconds, the thing comes in, you do the evaluation every 30 seconds, and if you have a network congestion, you say I have a lead time of 15 times 30 seconds. So 4.5 minutes. All right, so this means, and here because now I try to visualize that in my head. So you have a system that works, you put a network congestion into this thing that will lead to an SLA violation, and it takes 4.5 minutes for this to take place.
No.
It's
the 4.5.
15 times 30.
No, the 4.5 minutes here is the time between the first alarm,
mm-hmm,
and the time the effect of the congestion actually appears in the application
right.
level.
Right.
We
through an SLA violation.
Through an SLA violation. Right. Actually, because this is an experimental test bed.
Right.
And because we apply the most extreme congestion,
right.
we would assume that in the real networking environment, the rate at which the congestion appear would even may even be more slower than
that's, okay,
the
fine, fine. But still, it's hard for me to understand that you introduce a severe congestion. Now it takes 4.5 minutes, during which I do a lot of operations on my Rubies, and I get perfectly fine response time. And after 4.5 minutes, this thing starts getting slow. Why does it take so long? I would expect it to work much faster than that.
Because we were not actually okay. So in the experiment, mm-hmm. we were doing what I call in failure diagnosis community, where they do what we call active perturbation.
Right.
So they pick the system on the test and they inject force into it
right.
directly.
This was
in that case, you would expect no.
Uh-huh.
In that case, you would expect instant effect.
Uh-huh.
If we do that in the case of the cloud, we may raise questions from readers thinking that, oh, you just put what you want to see.
Right.
So what we did instead was to assume that the application on that test would be perfectly fine,
right.
getting the normal workload.
Right.
But instead, we emulated congestion from other applications sharing the same network link. And that is the reason why it may take some time before our application gets to see it. And this 15 minutes doesn't say anything about the time
at which, minutes, yeah.
It doesn't say anything about the time we injected we emulated the congestion
right.
and the time we see it. It only says that if we continue to monitor the system under test,
right.
we can 4.5 minutes ahead of time have a signal that says that it seems that this application is going to experience degradation.
All right. I still have some. Is this clear to you guys? Why it takes so long? Okay. You convince the audience. So let's go to the last bit.
You were the guy who thought it was very clear.
All right. Right. We go to page 238, figure 2. So this is where you use reinforcement learning for scaling. And it's similar than in the earlier work. Basically, you introduce a two-dimensional space. Now here it's slightly different. Here there's a response time, which has to do with an SLA, one achieve, and a CPU utilization. And you discretize the space and you use fuzzy set. And then you work with that, basically. That this is where you work. Now, the question is, and you do this for a very specific SLA, let's say 50 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds.
Oh, with SLA, with the three different SLAs.
Exactly. Now, the question is very good. So, my question is this partitioning of the space, is this dependent on the SLA? Are you doing this differently for each SLA or are you using the same? Because
I think
you probably should change, no? Change this thing for your algorithm to work.
Yeah. So we have to normalize. So because we're going to use the same state space.
Right.
We want to keep the exploration easy.
Right.
CPU is in the domain of 0 to 100. We have
right.
to normalize the response time also to that range.
Right.
What we did was that we, for the CPU, we have a fixed partitioning.
Right.
But the response time, we do not have a fixed partitioning because we have the normalization to 100. 0 to 100% means that when we are in the middle here, it means we are in the
right SLA.
So the partitioning is based on the normalization of using the SLA. Mm-hmm. So the SLA, this measurement in the middle, the center of the medium would be 50% for the
okay.
target.
I understand. Okay, makes sense. All right. So here, you take the CPU utilization as critical resource. Of course, one could do the same thing with memory, probably with network access. Can you do this with all at the same time? Can I have, say I have a CPU utilization, memory utilization, network access, and then I would also scale those? Let's say this is possible. You would have mechanism to do that. Could you use basically add several dimension here and design a system that way? Could you do that?
Okay. So the problem with that dual core with that is that the set space would be much more complicated.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to visualize. And it will take longer to explore with a single agent.
Aha.
So what I have seen that is possible, or what I've thought about,
right,
is to have some sort of we can still keep these two states,
right,
two dimension, but then we can sort of apply some sort of structures that we can use domain knowledge, because just like we use domain knowledge to get up to this,
mm-hmm,
we can use domain knowledge to understand what is the importance of if the application is to some extent compute intensive, or to another extent memory intensive, we can use this to build some sort of a hierarchical structure.
Mm-hmm.
So the state space will, so we'll basically have maybe a three-dimensional structure. But to be able to explore it, we can map, for example, these states,
mm-hmm,
with maybe not all the levels of memory.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we can only have this.
Okay.
So in that case, then we can have a reduced set of states.
So a very small state space is important for you.
It's very important in reinforcement learning, because it takes time to explore and also to store the memory of the key learning memory. It takes a huge.
Good point. Let's explore this a little. So and then you classify the state. So this means a system can be if you're here. Because again, you know, any point in time, the system is one. We have a vector here, and so here is the node is here, and so here it could be two states, huh? And here could be two states. So maximum could be four states.
Yes.
The system can be maximum four states. All right. So let's go to the. Can you show us the architecture? Your architecture, which is page. It's page 238, figure one. Yes. All right. And so, here comes the CPU value comes in, an SLA, and response time. So they change all the time.
Yes.
It's popping up. And so that gives you this specific state. Huh? And then now you want to explore the state. Basically,
we want to explore the states, the states action space.
Exactly. So what you want to do? You want to maximize the reward over a long time. Yeah? So you want to know how much you scale, whether you want to add for more capacity or less capacity, right? And that depends on which state you are.
Yes.
So for each state, you basically need one agent, no?
Yes.
Okay. So if you are in four states, then you might need four agents.
Maximum.
And so that would be, in your configuration, is the maximum parallelism you think. And the way this works, every one of these guys come up with a suggestion and they take some kind of a mean. This is what do they do?
Yes.
And then you see how the system reacts, and you know what the reward is. So this is the way you learn.
Yes.
All right. Now, okay. So how long does it take for such an agent to make the decision? Is it very fast? Or is it
we
fast?
Didn't quantify that, but it's very fast.
Right.
Because the learning is actually doing temporal smoothing.
Right.
We're actually not doing any complex mathematics.
We're
just tracking some changes.
Right. This is what I realized, and I want to, because when I first read this thing, oh, this is great AI. You know, you have these agents, everything's parallel, and they talk to each other, they come up with an interesting strategy, and then I read what you're actually doing, and I was very disappointed, basically. Some simple thing, four stages, you do something four times, okay? I would do this sequentially because it's so fast. So what I'm saying is, this looks great, but you're doing something very, very simple, no? I just wanted to hear this from you, right?
I didn't understand what you
said. I call this hype, no? Call it normally. Because you say, oh, this is, I have now all my agents and they talk to each other and cooperatively come up with a solution. But what we're actually doing is something very, very simple.
But then over time, each agent has to track its memory.
Fine.
So?
Fine. But it's still.
Because reinforcement learning itself, the methodologies are pretty very simple.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
So that's the reason.
The point is, it is not the case that each agent actually explores the state, because they come to a decision and then you make one experiment, one for all. No?
Yeah, we aggregate it.
Right.
Because you want to make the action.
So I just wanted to point this out. So for me, it was a mismatch between this grand scheme, and which probably holds in the macro channel setting as well, and what we're actually doing. But this is all that I want to talk about. So, right, then maybe we don't go to the formulas. Basically, what I found, you do Q-learning, yes? And so you for each iteration, you update.
Yes.
You update the state. I could not see how you initialize the state. You must have initialization.
So this is what we use as control matrix. We use this for two things. First is to initialize the state, and second is to sort of guide the agents. That's how, because it's hard to talk about reinforcement learning in very technical terms that people will understand. Mm-hmm. So we usually in different domains, people come up with metaphors to explain this. So the control mappings is used to initialize states and action mappings, to initialize the Q table. And then we have some states and action mappings that we want to discourage. For example, if we know that the performance is high and the utilization is high, we probably don't want to add more resources, neither do we want to reduce the resource.
Right.
So in that case, we would like to find a way to discourage the agent from taking those actions. So what we did was we used this control mapping. I have an equation there that sort of set in the beginning a negative value to the state action pairs. So over time, the increment will be smaller. And then when we maximize that, it will be small. So we cannot, the agent will be discouraged from taking those actions in those states.
Okay, good. Now, okay, I think I understand. From what you wrote in your thing, in your platform, such a control cycle goes, so every 10 seconds,
yes,
basically you initiate such a control cycle. In the load pattern you're using, every 5 minutes the load pattern changes. And for me, there's a mismatch between this 10 second, this very rapid control cycle, because I cannot imagine a system that you actually scale every 10 seconds, or am I wrong? So the load changes very slowly. Every 5 minutes the load changes, but you evaluate the scale every 10 seconds.
Yeah.
Why is this?
The reason is that we are doing interactive learning.
Mm-hmm.
If we do a batch learning, which is basically what you're suggesting, if we should wait, we might experience a situation like the graph that I showed earlier, a situation where, because it takes time for you to track over time the changes in the states and take actions continuously. If we wait to have the same alignment between the control action points and the workload action, we would end up in a situation where we already experienced performance degradation
right.
for a far longer time
right.
than we would like to have.
Okay.
So this interactive continuous adjustment helps us to prevent that. And by the time we get to this change in workload, we get something.
So there's no other way that you could trigger this than just the time, the periodicity? Because one could also say something changes, so now I evaluate.
Well, we can change. The time sequence is not constant. We can also try with different.
I understand, but that would still be periodic.
So if I
would design the system, I would try to find a trigger which is not periodic. I would. Isn't there any kind of metric I could track, and if that changes, then I would initiate that.
And that means you are going to miss some experiences.
Uh-huh.
If we trigger on demand, we're going to miss. Experience, because here we're not building a model.
Right.
It would be different if we build a model.
Right.
And then say that we plug in the current state, tell us the capacity. But here we don't have any model, we just look at the observations. We continuously observe the system, try to take some action. Sometimes the agent will take zero, they will take null actions.
Right.
Because they figure out, especially in those stable periods.
That's what I would expect. Is
yes.
What's happen.
So that's what they do.
All right.
Of the time.
Okay. So I accept that you thought longer of that than me. Okay. Can you look at the page 246? That basically shows how the system evolves over time. Right. Any of these graphs you do essentially. Now. What I would have expected to see is that the system learns over time. You know, we do Q learning, reinforcement learning. This means that the system, I would have expected, the system makes maybe bad decision at the beginning, but gets better over time through experience. And I cannot see this here.
But we can, for some workloads, we can see this oscillation in the beginning.
Uh-huh.
And then for some other workloads, we can also see that, and it depends on the targets.
Right.
If we're trying to meet high targets, where performance requirement becomes very difficult. And the reason why you do not see this is because we are doing online reinforcement learning, online Q-learning implementation,
mm-hmm.
where we sort of start the Q-learning memory at the conservative state.
Mm-hmm.
So we set everything to zero,
mm-hmm.
and then it increases over time. In the typical deployment of reinforcement learning, you should have a pre-adaptation phase where you would train the technique to learn over time. And this is what we did by the control mappings that I told you earlier. So we basically just prevented some action from taking place in some states, and that seems to sort of eliminate these bad initial starts.
All right. So you already, what you're seeing is already the system is already pretty converged in terms of good policies or optimal policies.
Not necessarily, not the whole state space, but at least we use domain knowledge to kickstart this.
Right, okay, then is it fair to say, yes, the system is getting better from here to here, but the improvement is relatively small, so I cannot really see it visually?
Well, we could show this.
I'm just saying, but what I naturally would have expected, don't you have here two new curves? I would expect it here, you know, big difference, and then over time, big difference, smaller.
But I think it's because of this is a compressed. And if I would plot this
uh-huh.
at 10 seconds, the control interval,
mm-hmm.
and show only the first 5 minutes, I guess we would be able to see what you want. But usually, if you want to see that in Q-learning, what mm-hmm. we do is to instead, look at the evolution of the Q values
mm-hmm.
themselves.
Mm-hmm.
But then, in a paper, it would be difficult to put all the possible Q value for each state and action matrix.
Yeah, no, I understand.
So then, what happens is that we usually experience in the beginning, the Q value would grow steadily.
Right.
And then, at the point, it will stabilized. Right, that's right. What you would like
exactly,
to see.
Exactly.
I didn't put it in this.
All right.
And I didn't have. I don't have it on.
Okay, but it's, right. it's happening. But
I
it's
saw it, and that is what.
Just a visibility. Okay, fair enough.
At a point, it will learn, which is where it learns that it should no longer explore. It should right. exploit what is already
right.
learned.
Right. Okay. Great. I have a final question, and that is, I commended you that you did all this evaluation, and I really felt this is the strength of your work. There is one exception where I don't see that, and that is with this landscape, and then the ranking of the nodes. You basically have two ranking schemes, no, which were introduced. But that is never really evaluated.
Yes, I also mentioned in the paper, uh-huh. which is the paper 5, uh-huh. That we didn't put the evaluation in this case because we have a small landscape.
Right.
If we would have a large landscape, then it would be easy for us to have two
results. Right.
So and then since the focus actually was on detection
right.
rather than ranking, we only added the ranking as some sort of thing to order the animals.
Okay.
So that's the reason why we didn't.
All right. So then, okay. I think this everything I have. Nice piece of work. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So then we move over to questions from the committee, and as we often do, I'd like to start with the person traveling the furthest to come here, so please, Julian.
So thank you, and thanks also for the initial presentation and insightful. So just a few questions, I'd like in particular to gather some general reflections from you. After all this work you've done, a bit, I want to understand the way you see anomaly detection in general. One first point I'd like to touch is that one of the assumptions in this work, I think, is that you can do anomaly detection based on time series of performance data, right? But when I think to the industry, I see also the situation where you are collecting a lot of events from log data. You have a lot of other information which is not really about performance. And that, I think, is important for anomaly detection. It can help you discriminate which things are true anomalies or not. So a bit, I'd like to understand your view on these, how your work fits, and when is it justified to take your approach versus whether it's better to use other techniques?
So the reason, first reason why we looked at the time series approach for anomaly detection is that we were studying mostly performance metrics. And performance metrics, whether they be from servers or VMs or applications, they are usually temporal, they are time dependent. So, and in some existing work, I've seen situations where people basically just disregard these obvious characteristics and just apply, a classification technique to maybe naive bias to do regression and classify. The point here is that we end up having false alarms because of the nature of the technique. And then the second thing, reason is that most of the standard machine learning techniques are very good with when you have ground truth labels. It turns out that most of the data that we have that are available for performance systems, they are time series and they are not labeled. It's even hard for them to label them. If we should use clustering techniques would assume that there is no dependence. For example, in paper 5, where we look at the multivariate features of CPU utilization, memory utilization. But the multivariate data that we consider is from a single VM or a single host. It's different from the kind of data that clustering would use, where you could have a single multivariate record of the memory utilization, CPU utilization, disk, network of a single VM, and then you can have this collected from thousands of VMs. Then you end up with what we call the cross-sectional data. So the data that we're working in, work on in this thesis is sort of time series. So we collect multivariate features from the same load over time. It's different from the typical machine learning techniques where they collect sort of features from different nodes, but not over time, at a specific time. If you have a data center with 1,000 nodes, if you collect for each node, if you collect the memory utilization and the resource utilization into, let's say, 4, 5, 6, 10 dimensions, then at time t, at that point, you're going to get data sets that are containing about 10,000 samples, right? And then you can cluster that. You can apply very interesting one-class SVMs, ANN, deep learning, and to do this clustering and prediction. But the kind of result that you're going to get in that case will be different from the kind of interpretation that you're going to get in the case that we look at here. So in that case, in the cross-sectional case, you can begin to talk about, okay, we can partition, for example, you can cluster the data set into nodes that are high on CPU utilization but low on the rest, and then nodes that are low on the on disk I/O but high on memory utilization. If we do that, if we do clustering with our technique, it will work, because if you throw machine learning data to machine learning algorithms to any data, to give you some result. But it will be hard to come up with interpretations. What will end up is we could have some situation where it will tell us that at some point, the majority, the VM was consuming too much memory or too much CPU. But this changes over time, so it's hard to say exactly what is it. So that's the reason why we looked at time series techniques, and we can do easy prediction without needing labels. And secondly, you mentioned about logs. The reason why we didn't, I've not considered logs is, number one, logs are very agnostic to the application that you're dealing with. Of course, we can also consider system event logs. But then we would be, we were looking at root cause analysis, where we want to figure out if the cause of performance degradation is due to cache trashing or some misses or some application code bugs, then that's where log analytics will come into play. In this case, we don't have to do it in real time, because it's hard to get log in real time like in the case of performance metrics. So we will have to take the logs offline and use it to support the investigation by the engineers to figure out if an observed performance anomaly or changes in the CPU utilization in a particular VM can be explained by, say, access problems with the access log from the Apache web server running inside the VM. So basically, the log analytics is, from the papers that I've seen, they use it to support root cause analysis. And that is not really the main goal of this work. The interest was that we wanted to be able to make use of the performance metrics that we have in order to do some sort of management.
Any other? There's also another method that you could consider here, which is to, say, inject transactions or do some sort of distributed tracking of the request. And they do these in distributed systems, and you can have a deeper monitoring, the granularity, finer monitoring granularity of the level of the individual boxes. What do you think about that?
Yeah, that is a well recognized technique in this field. In the survey, I classify this as a strategy, which I call the flow dependency analysis. So this is one of the methods that is predominant in the distributed arena. They basically trace transactions across different nodes and try to figure out where you have delays and characterize these delays. But what it turns out that the tracing and injection require that you know the application, how many components you have, or find a way to be able to discover this component. You know the topology of the of, the application, and this could be different from different applications. We were not really, and there was quite a lot of work in that area already, but we're not really interested in that part because we were looking at the infrastructure as a service situation, which was our VMs, and we assumed that the applications running inside them, we don't know. We just wanted the one of the three requirements that I mentioned is generalization. We want to be able to adapt the same technique to different VMs or hosts without having to do too much, asking for too much information or support from the application providers.
I have just another question, Montkowski's again, about the general approach. I get the impression to some of these papers that you're assuming that these applications are living in a rather stationary or static environment. For example, in the landscape graphs, I see all these dependencies and all these connections between the architectural element and the infrastructure, but then when you reason about the actual management techniques in place, there are the load balances, there is a fair sharing of resources, there are software-defined mechanisms that can dynamically change this environment. And similarly, when you work on the reinforcement learning, I think one of the assumptions you had there is that there is an environment that is stationary in the system. So I didn't get a sense.
Not the environment stationary, but we wanted the environment to be non-stationary, so that when we take actions, we get at any point in time when we take action, we get different results.
So he says it is also supposed that the environment is stationary, so that the probability of state transitions or receiving specific values of the reinforcement signal is fixed over time.
Oh, okay. I think what I mean by that is that the states, the stationarity of the state is not in terms of the application or the nodes on which the application is, but in terms of the state space. The two-dimensional state space.
Okay, so just a word.
Yeah.
Okay, but I want to understand your thoughts about the applicability of the methods. Okay. You've developed in these more dynamic environments, particularly, for example, the landscape graphs.
Okay. So with the landscape thing, we actually got the idea from working with Intel. And the real idea, we understand that this could change. And that is the reason why we had to put in the ranking. And the ranking doesn't consider static graph. At any point in time, in paper 3, I explained that the generation of the landscape is the generation of the building landscape is done by an agent that consults an OpenStack database to be able to, at any point in time, this landscape could change. And that's why we also discussed about subgraphs. So we can extract subgraphs and look at how these subgraphs evolve over time. What I mean is that if you have a single application, over time, maybe 1 hour ago, there were only three components in the application and two servers. An hour later, it could be that we have scaled up and then we have four or five servers. The ranking technique would be able to handle that. But this doesn't have anything to do with anomaly detection because we're dealing with metrics rather than the actual nodes. So it is the ranking that has to do with this change, and that is exactly why we provided, we used the graph theoretic techniques, which is mostly agnostic to this different shape of the graph, or as long as it's a directed acyclic graph. That's the only thing that's in, that is directed, and these edges represent some form of logical relationship between the nodes. We really do not, but in the thesis, we have not been able to demonstrate that, and that will be the interesting thing he mentioned, which is that when we actually do the ranking, the evaluation of the ranking, and that is where the evaluation will really look, that will be the sweet spots. Because then we can actually show that as the landscape changes over time, the ranking seems to be consistent and accurate. We have not been able to do that, but it will be an interesting thing to look into.
there in that part of the landscape graph, I didn't fully get why you didn't seem to leverage a lot the possibility of annotating arcs with weights, labeling arcs with weights. I mean, but I think, for example, to load balancing, it's quite natural to think that the dependencies might not be equal if you are splitting the load on different machines differently. You might want to reflect that your graph with weights. Is this something you've considered?
So that's the point. The graph is agnostic of whatever type of application. But in this case, you're talking about load balancer, and then we can label or we can weight. We can give the edges weights based on the probability of the way the load balancer distributes requests to different nodes. Yeah. But if we do that, then it means that our technique will be good only for load balancers. But what if we're not interested in that kind of weighting, but we're interested in just something that gives us an idea of what has happened and how we can reason about it. So that's why we didn't really go deep into the designing for different type of application. If you were looking at a cluster of load balancers, yeah, it would be interesting to consider the weight as not as static dependencies, but also as weighted links.
Thank you very much. So that moves us to Simi.
All right. Let me first start by congratulating you on doing a lot of hard work on a very hard problem, as Dolf mentioned. So nobody would have expected you to solve this problem in one thesis. I would, with the limited time I have available, I have a lot of questions and discussions to make. I read your thesis with a lot of interest, and if there is an opportunity, you come and give a seminar in Asia, if I can discuss with you for hours. But let me just, in this limited time, pick up a couple of questions. One is about the choice of your baseline, and the other is the very notion of anomaly. The basics. Okay, so with respect to baselines, I would like to know how you chose your baselines, and how I would have what I was missing amongst your baselines. I can discuss later. Maybe what you can discuss.
So the detection techniques can be classified in the ones that use this rules, domain rules, and the one that uses incremental length. The problem with incremental or online techniques is that it actually truly needs some sort of offsetting baseline. So in our work, for example, in paper 4 and paper 5, which is where this is relevant, we state the assumption that we assume that we have a first window of pure observation, where the system is in a good state, and then we can take this baseline as a baseline and then learn over time.
Ah, maybe you don't get my notion of baseline then, because you use baseline in two ways, I noticed that.
Okay.
I'm not talking about how you learn your model in some sense. That's not my notion of baseline. My notion of baseline is typically when you're evaluating your method, including your choice of the other baseline, in order to show you that your method is good.
Okay.
So for example, in your paper 5, if you want to, because you're in paper 5 here, you're actually comparing with the RL-based baseline controller.
Yes.
So
okay,
I'm asking
okay.
you, what could have used instead of that? And why did you choose that? And what would have been, I can tell you maybe what would have been my choice, but
what I would use instead of this would be a model-based technique.
Why model-based? Because you're using another technique, right?
So yes, I'm using a model-free technique. Mm-hmm. And the model-based technique is what pervades the literature.
Oh, but if you have something and the other one doesn't have it, they are not comparable, right? So, what is a good way of measuring something if you don't want if you want to be fair to yourself and fair to the other one?
It is this concern that made us look at this. So we were wondering that the reader could be concerned that, oh, but that is model based and this is not model based. Why don't you compare with something else? And since we claim to have extended or adapted the Q-learning for our problem, it would be fair to see how the adapted technique fared better or because if you're any better than the standard technique, which is what in many simpler problems people just employ this and it seems to work. But then we found out that in a complex situation like this, when you have you want to balance efficiency with performance, and then you have some complex performance requirement, it could be tricky to use this direct method. And that is the reason why we did this. Another thing that we could also have benchmarked this with is to, there are some existing papers who have done similar thing that we have done, but they have considered learning, formulating the state as containing the workload and the performance. So basically they learn the mapping between performance and workload. In that case, we assume that we have this access to this workload over time. But in the real cloud, you may really not have this access. So this makes the work a bit more complicated. And that's why we try to capture that with the CPU utilization. Another thing we could also have compared it with would be, so here we're doing vertical scaling. What will happen if we have horizontal scaling instead? Or what if we mix these two together? So that would be alternatives that we would consider. But then that would be, the goal then would not be about if the method works, but it will be if the method works on different type of actions. So that's the reason why we use this.
So as only in this paper you're actually doing some kind of mitigation.
Yes.
You're not only following the traffic, you're actually trying to perform an action. I would have maybe in this particular case, for example, I would have compared it with a perfect reactor, meaning a best case, an optimal allocator. And I would see, okay, this is the gap I get. I don't say that you should come to the perfect, of course, but the gap would be interesting. How far from the gap, you know, from the perfect I can be with this method?
Because
close to the gap would have been, to the top would have been very
the perfect, there are two perfect, not two, the perfect allocator here would be to over-provision the resource. So we want to prevent the...
But you have two criteria, right? You have efficiency as well.
Yes.
So you, I would put the perfect allocator with respect to both criteria.
Mm. And then we could
sort of oracles.
In that case, then we could use a threshold allocator. We have a
whatever. I mean, you would have to construct your baseline carefully to make sure that, you know. So that's one example, but I have many such examples I can discuss with you.
Okay.
The other question I really wanted to ask you is about the notion of anomaly, because when I was reading the first part, the umbrella part, I was, contrary to Rolf, I was very confused because I'm not in your area, I'm from the dependability area, and the notions were quite often confusing me, the use of words, because they're used in different ways, in different communities, that's acceptable. But then I was thinking, okay, maybe I should understand anomaly as a notion of trying to find early warnings for something worse to happen. Because, I mean, if I want to find something...
Symptoms, basically.
Symptoms is, is a good word, because independently you would call it the pre-stage to a failure. And that bit would make sense, but you call it... Yeah, let's not get into that. Terminology discussion. If it's early warning, but then I would like to find somewhere where you find a benefit of finding the anomaly in time, or well, you had this discussion about lead time. Maybe we could go back to that, and how far you. How early you discuss things, and it took me actually, I think, until page 186, where I could actually see the notion of early warning. So some of the early parts of the thesis, I was quite confused. What are we actually doing? Because if you are load following or load controlling, there are many ways of doing it. But if you are really trying to do early warning, this it lost its focus.
So what we are, doing is not really early warning. Mm-hmm. In that paper, we only show that if we correlate anomalies, alarms on the system level and SLA violation at the application level, we can be able to, ahead of time, know that, okay, there is going to be SLA violation. The SLA violation itself is an anomaly. The change in the metric itself is an anomaly.
So
the notion of anomaly in the context of performance metrics is the same as the notion of anomalies in any time series problem. So here we're looking at different type of anomalies that I think I tried to discuss that in the introduction. So we looked at, for example, point anomalies, contextual anomalies, and collective anomalies. So in this case, the anomalies, what we call anomalies, are measurements that are either points, because they are significantly different from the rest of the data, or contextual, in the sense that they happen in time points where at one point it is normal, at another point it is not. So it is this measurement that we call anomalies. Okay. We call them anomalies because they are.
I understand this. Okay. This is fine. So let's go then to your page 174 and to the charts that you have there. So this is Yahoo data, and I would then say that okay, if you're looking at the data characteristic, the first four, which are not the synthetic data. The first four charts are really data coming into the data center. And well, I mean, that's life. You know, if you have this level shift, it's not an anomaly. You know, it's not coming into my system and I should manage it. Either I provided for it or thought about it, or I didn't. If I didn't think about it, it's not an anomaly.
Yes, the data, this data is little. Though we didn't take advantage of the labeling in the modeling.
Yeah.
So it's actually, we have a ground truth that tells us which is anomaly and which is not. So it is the job of the technique to discriminate. Of course, here in the beginning, when we looked at the book, so this annotation is based on the label from Yahoo themselves.
I know, but if I was going to just do some kind of load control, I would consider this as a classic load control problem, and there are methods of saying, okay, now I have to shift my regime. It's not about detecting an anomaly. It's not related to this.
But this change is actionable in the case of web applications or cloud applications.
Exactly.
Because we want to see this change, and maybe we have to, this alarms is a signal to increase capacity because you are entering a new regime. Yes.
So these are actually calling for different types of techniques to do for different objectives. And what I was missing, if I have to summarize at this point, is that in your umbrella, after you're defining the problem state, I just saw this last chapter, which says paper one does this, paper two does this, paper four. I didn't get this summation chapter. I would have liked actually to get the summation chapter. It says, okay, what did I learn after doing all these papers? If I have different types of data and different types of applications, and some of them are actually better dealt with some other community, well, maybe I should not call it anomaly. And I did it because who called it anomaly and labeled it? But maybe it was really not an anomaly. Here is where my methods would have actually made sense with my hindsight, with 5 years of work. This is something I was missing. So.
Yes, I think maybe the
Maybe I can shift between some of my methods and switch between some of when I see this kind of problem, I use this one, and I see that kind of problem, I use that one. And now with my knowledge, I can switch between them and know when to apply them. Mm. That chapter I was missing.
Yeah. The term anomaly in this case can be expected or not expected. In this case, it seems like it's unexpected. Because if we are learning from the past, and then that sharp change in level is something that is actionable. And that is the reason I suggest that. I think that is the reason why it is labeled as anomalous. And you can see that afterwards, it is no longer an anomaly because it is just the change that we want to recognize. So this change, so the change itself is what is anomaly, not the observation in this case. in the case of the changing level.
Okay, so if your traffic is causing such a big jump, usually your users notice it at the same time than any method would describe it.
This metric may actually not be traffic. It could be, let's say, maybe number of messages, because here we're having very high.
Yeah.
Maybe number of messages going into or being transmitted in the system, or number of errors in this case. If the errors suddenly jump up like that, it may not be bad, but it could just signify that something happened.
Okay.
And that's why we call it actionable. Maybe we should have defined the term properly under different umbrellas, like you suggested.
Okay. Yeah. We can discuss later. I'm sure there is a lot of time to discuss later. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. My name is Johanna.
Thank you. So I'm not a professional, even amateur, beginners. So my first question is: in the CAPTCHA, you list a number of alternative taxonomies, and you say that none of them claims to be complete.
Yes.
But now that you finished your PhD, almost. Has any one of them proved particularly useful for you? I mean, is there one of them that you feel is really helpful in your work?
Okay, I will.
So it's the symptom manifestation cause model, change up the structure model, and so forth. So, it starts on page 22.
Okay. So I wrote this, this thesis, and this. I found out about them just before I started my thesis, when I was writing some of the papers. So when I was writing the survey, it was either that some of these papers were in parallel, were in publication at the same time, or some of them came after the survey. The reason why I have them included here is just to show that there are different ways of looking at characterizing problems, how problems flow from one point to another. For example, this one comes from a software engineering paper in the software engineering community. The goal here, they were looking at software regression. In their own community, regression, that is the change between one version, in performance, between one version of an application, maybe when it is offline in development, and when it is deployed eventually, that change is what we call the regression. And the goal here is to, when we detect this regression, the goal is to figure out where the problem could be in the new system or in the new release. And this author proposed this pyramid to demonstrate specific type of root causes, for example, large updates request. Updates could be update to a role in the database or something, and the messages are passed across the. So here, this is more into the application that we're dealing with. And this is not the final, it's just like a template that you can change it for another application and transfer it to something else. So I think this is quite useful, but I would think that this is really good for high-level management, and when you want to discuss problems at a very high level, you want to deal with stakeholders, then this is good. Because it's a template as well, and we can have generic or high-level terms of different type of problems, consider some as triggers, where it is coming from, if it's the servers or it's coming from the application, and the kind of impact it would have. This also is useful when we are looking at end user performance in, say, for example, latency. And then this tells us different type of problems from where different type of latency delay can stem. Our proposal is a bit higher level, because then we are more interested in how the flow, how bottlenecks, because for some people, anomalies, it's hard to distinguish what is anomaly, what is bottlenecks, what is root causes. in different articles you get different definitions. Here, the goal is to sort of give an example and sort of show how this flows. You have problems, for example, misconfiguring a VM or a server can lead to some sort of contention, because then you're perhaps inadvertently reduce the number of CPUs that is needed. And then when the user sees that, it's going to see it as some sort of maybe application that is hanging or delayed. So this sort of helps us to understand the difference, the relationship between anomalies, bottleneck, and root causes in terms of the cause effect.
Okay, so all taxonomies are useful in Omega
Hospital. Yeah, somewhat.
Okay, then these diagnosis tools that you develop, where do you think that they will have greatest impact in the short-term future? Because I guess some problems are basically impossible to discover, and others are trivial to discover. So your techniques, is there any particular kind of problems where they will really add value?
So on the one hand, we have the anomaly detection techniques, yes. And on the second hand, we have the mitigation techniques. Mm-hmm. The mitigation techniques is, I think, would have a very good impact in different applications, especially in cases where, as I mentioned, we don't have models. And for that reason alone, and the fact that we make fewer assumptions about the application, the type of data we are working with. So we don't even need data to get the learning started. But I think that is going to be very useful in cases where you have heterogeneity of services, different type of services, not just in cloud. It could be IoT network, for example. You have different sensors, and these sensors can change and they come around like that. You want a technique to be able to observe them, tweak, or tune them over time and then adjust their capacity, something like that. And the anomaly detection techniques would, of course, be useful for not just anomaly detection. The techniques could be used for predicting and supporting other type of cloud management, for load balancing, migrating load from contented servers to another server that is a bit not so contented.
Okay, and the final question is, if curiosity was the only factor, then how would you continue now?
Well, if curiosity was the only factor, yes. I have a lot of things to be curious about. Number one, I have a lot of ways that I think I could improve some of the work, and based on some of the suggestions here, the discussions, I have many things to do. For example, in the mitigation approach, the techniques that we use, the formulation of the problem assume that, okay, we're only dealing with capacity, performance degradation caused by capacity shortage. In some other cases, that may not be the case. The problem could be a contention. I did an experiment in the paper, and I presented it, that our technique overcompensates in terms of capacity when there is contention, where the problem is not the load, but there is a contention. And it was not able to, it was able to control, adapt the capacity, but it over-allocated resources. We would like to look more into that and find a way to quantify this sensitivity to different noise in the cloud. And we have a couple of more things we'd like to do.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Johanna. Finally, then we leave the show open to anyone to ask any further questions. Well, we have continued for so long, so we are exhausted from the listening. Sita Knoll is taking the chance to do that, so then I would like to end this by thanking everyone involved. Thank you, Muri, for presentation and good discussions, and Rolf for also a presentation and equally good discussion. And finally, the committee and for questions and discussions, and also for reading and putting a lot of effort into understanding this work. And thanks to everyone else for coming here today. And for now, for everyone now, there is coffee and cake, as I would expect, up in the coffee room, while the committee is meeting in a conference room nearby. Thank you very much.